Section 1 of The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1. The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1 by Henry Baerlein. Preface.
On a mild February afternoon, I was waiting for the train at a wayside station in northwestern Banat. So unimportant was that station that it was connected neither by telegraph nor telephone with any other station, and thus there was no means of knowing how long I would have to wait. The movements of the train in those parts could never, so I gathered, be foretold, and on that afternoon it was uncertain whether a strike had prevented it from leaving New Arad, the starting point. Occasionally the rather elegant station master, and occasionally the porter with the round, disarming face, raised their voices in prophecy. But they were increasingly unable, so far at least as I was concerned, to modify the feelings of dullness that were caused by the circumstances and by the dreary nature of the surroundings, a plain with several uninteresting little lakes upon it. There was time enough for meditation. I was wondering if I would ever understand the people of the Balkans. 1 hour, and then another slipped away, and the lakes began to be illuminated by the setting sun. A handful of prospective travelers and their friends were also waiting, and as one of them produced a violin, we all began to dance the Serbian kolo, which is performed by an indefinite number of people who have to be hand in hand, irrespective of sex, forming in this way a straight line or a circle or a serpent-like series of curves. They go through certain simple evolutions into which more or less energy and sprightliness are introduced. The station master looked on approvingly and then decided to join us, and after a little time he was followed by the porter. Our violinist was in excellent form, so that we continued dancing until some of us were as crimson as the sun. And presently, while I was resting, what with the beauty of the scene and the exhilaration of the dance, I found myself thinking that, after all, I might, within a reasonable time, understand these people. Then a new arrival, a middle-aged, benevolent-looking woman with a basket on her arm, came past me.
Dobre vieche, said I. Good evening.
Zivio, said she. May you live long.
Nevertheless, I hope in this book to give a description of how the Yugoslavs, brothers and neighbors and tragically separated from one another for so many centuries, made various efforts to unite, at least in some degree. But for about 15 centuries the greater number of Yugoslavs were unable to liberate themselves from their alien rulers. Not until the end of the Great War were these dominations overthrown and the kindred peoples, the Serbs, Croats, and Slovenes, put at last before the realization of their dreams. The dreams, that is to say, of some of their poets and statesmen and bishops and philologists, as well as of certain foreigners. But listen to this. By the censorious literature who contributes the musings without method, to MAGA. We do not envy the ingenious gentleman, says he, who invented the two new states, Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia. Their composite names prove their composite characters. That they will last long beneath the fanciful masks which have been put on them, we do not believe. Even so, might some uninstructed person in Yugoslavia or South Slavia proceed to wash his hands of that ingenious man who invented Mega's home, North Britain. I see that our friend in the following number of Mega, March 1920, says that foreign affairs are
a province far beyond his powers or understanding.
But he is talking of Mr. Lloyd George. Our account of medieval times will be brief, only so much, in fact, as is needed for a comprehension of the present. In approaching our own day, the story will become more and more detailed. if it be objected that the details, insofar as they detract from the conduct of Yugoslavia's neighbors, might with advantage have been painted with the hazy, quiet colors that you give to the excursions and alarms of long ago, one may reply that this book is intended to depict the world in which the Yugoslavs have, after all these centuries, joined one another and the frame of mind which consequently glows in them. One cannot, on this earth, expect that a new state, however belated and however inevitable, will be formed without a considerable amount of friction, both external and internal. Perhaps owing to the number of not overly friendly states with which they are encompassed, the Yugoslavs will manage to waive some of their internal differences and to show that they are capable, despite the confident assertion of some of their neighbors and the croakings of some of themselves, of establishing a state that will weather for many a year the storms which even the League of Nations may not be competent to banish from southeastern Europe. A certain number of people, who seem to expect us to take them seriously, assert that an English writer is disqualified from passing adverse comment on Italy's imperialistic aims because the British Empire has received, as a result of the war, some Turkish provinces and German colonies. It is said that, in view of these notorious facts, the Italian nationalists and their friends cannot bear to be criticized by the pens of British authors and journalists. The fallacy in logic, known as the argumentum ad hominem, becomes a pale thing in comparison with this new argumentum ad terram. If a passionless historian of the Eskimos had given his attention to the Adriatic, I believe he would have come to my conclusions. But then, it might be said of him that as for half the year, his land is swathed in darkness. It would be unseemly for him to discuss a country which is basking in the sun. Another consummation, though this will today find, especially in Serbia, a great many opponents whose attitude, following the deplorable events of the Great War, can cause us no surprise, is the adhesion after certain years of Bulgaria to the Yugoslav state. I wrote these words a few months ago. They are already out of date. The general opinion in Serbia is voiced by a Serbian war widow who, writing in Politika, one of the newspapers of Belgrade, replied to Stambolewski, the Bulgarian peasant premier, who was always uncompromisingly opposed to the fratricidal war with Serbia. He had been saying that the Serbs and other Yugoslavs prefer to postpone the reconciliation until, quote, "the grass grows over the graves of their women and children whom our officials destroyed." And this war widow answered that it was not necessary for the grass to grow, but that they should condemn the culprits by a regular court as prescribed in the treaty, quote, "fulfill the undertaking you have assumed, for only so shall we know that you will fulfill other undertakings in the future." If it had not been for the great powers, especially Russia and Austria, the union of Serbia and Bulgaria might have occurred long ago. Wise persons, such as Prince Michael of Serbia, and the British travelers, Miss Irby, Bosnia's lifelong benefactress, and her relative, Miss Moyer Mackenzie, had this aim in view during the 60s of last century. So had a number of other excellent folk who recognized that the two people were naturally drawn to one another. Quote, "the hatred between the two people is a fact which is as saddening in the thought for the future as in the record of the past. But it is a fact to ignore, which is simply a mark of incompetence. The two nations are antipathetic," says Mr. A. H. E. Taylor in his The Future of the Southern Slavs, a painstaking, if rather clumsy book, London, 1917, in which we are shown that the writer is well acquainted with general history. But in the opinion of an erudite Serb to whom I showed this passage, Mr. Taylor knows nothing of Serb and Bulgar under the Turks, There is no single document nor anything else that speaks of hatred between them. On the contrary, they were always on friendly terms. The antagonisms of the Middle Ages, as Mr. Taylor surely knows, were the work of rulers who paid no attention to the national will. There was, at that time, no national consciousness, and just as a Serbian would wage war with a Bulgarian prince, so would he do battle with a Croat or with another Serbian ruler. Mr. Taylor talks of, quote,
the almost constant state of warfare between Serbs and Bulgars.
But he does not mention that there were many cases during the late war in which the men showed friendliness to one another. He may argue that if a soldier calls out brother to his foe and subsequently slays him, there is not much to be said for his friendliness. But surely that is to draw no distinction between what is the soldier's pleasure and his business.
Nothing, observes Mr. Taylor very truly. Nothing in the Balkan Peninsula is so desirable as the laying aside of the feud.
He may take it that this feud has been aroused and maintained among the intelligentsia and for political reasons, with Macedonia in the forefront. I think he would not be so severe on those who are, quote,
ignorant apparently that the mutual animosity has its roots deep down in the history and historical consciousness of Serb and Bulgar.
If he remembered that the Bulgars wanted Michael for their prince, and if he had been present at the siege of Adrianople, where the Serbian and Bulgarian soldiers, in their eagerness to fraternize, took to speaking their respective languages incorrectly, the Serb dropping his cases and the Bulgar his article, in the hope that they would thus make themselves more easily understood. It seems to me not only more advisable, but more rational, to ponder upon such incidents than upon the idle controversies as to which army was the most deserving, and I do not think it is evidence of any widespread Bulgarian animosity because a certain official decided to charge the Serbian government a fee for conveying back to Serbia the corpses of their soldiers. With regard to the two languages, the difference between them will matter no more than does the difference between Serbo-Croatian and Slovene. The Serb-Croat-Slovene state has been astonishingly little commoted by the fact that the Slovene language is quite distinct, the two tongues being only in a moderate degree mutually intelligible. The Slovenes have never been exposed to the influence either of Byzantium or of the Turks, so that their language is free from the Orientalisms which abound in the southern dialects. But it is curious to note that many of the Slovene archaisms of form and structure, such as the persistence of the V for U and the final L of the past participle, which have disappeared from Serbo-Croat, have been preserved in the dialects of Macedonia. The Bulgarian language, the southeastern Serbian dialects, as well as Romanian and Albanian, have certain grammatical peculiarities through being influenced by the language of the Romanized Thracio-Illyrian peoples with whom they merged. Even Montenegro was to some degree influenced by this process, having lost one or two cases, such as the locative. In Serbia, one uses seven cases. The Montenegrin generally contents himself with about five, and in some dialects they are all discarded. The amount of Turanian, Pechenag, and other undesirable blood in the Bulgars does not, let the two or three eccentric Bulgars say what they will, prevent them being far more Yugoslav than anything else. Professor Sivic, the famous rector of Belgrade University, has made personal examinations in Bulgaria, and is of the opinion that a great part of that people, for instance, at Ternovo in the middle of Bulgaria, is physically and spiritually very near to the Serbs. The Mongol influence, he thinks, is so scattered that it is very difficult to see. Unhappily, however, in the last 30 or 40 years, an enormous amount of hatred has been piled up between Serb and Bulgar. Things have happened which we as outsiders can more easily forget than those and the orphans of those who have suffered. Atrocities have taken place. International commissions have recorded some of them, and non-Balkan writers have produced a library of lurid and almost always strictly one-sided books about them. I suggest that these gentlemen would have been better employed in translating the passages wherein Homer depicts precisely the same atrocities. Whatever may seem good to Balkan controversialists, let us of the West rather try, for their sake and for ours, to bring these two people together. We have a good foundation on which to build. Every Bulgar will tell you that he is full of admiration of the Serbian army, and the Serbs will speak in a similar strain of the Bulgars. Also, the Serbs will tell you that, no matter what else they may be able to do, they are, as compared with the Bulgars, quite incompetent in the diffusion of propaganda, while the Bulgars will explain to you that in propaganda the Serbs are immensely their superiors. Balkan propaganda does not confine itself to using with violence the sword and the pen. In its higher flights, it will, in a disputed district, bury ancient-looking stones with suitable inscriptions. It will go beyond the simple changes in the termination of the surnames upon those who come under its dominion. The name upon a tombstone will be made to end according to circumstances. In off or vich, sometimes in the Romanian esco or the Greek apollos. If this is known to the departed, one would like to learn how it affects them. A great deal of energy has been brought to bear in the production of official books which place on record the repugnant details of all the crimes that have ever been imagined by men or ghouls. Which crimes, so say the Book of Nation A, have been committed by the incredible monsters of Nation B. At times, from motives of economy, the same photographs have been used by both nations, an idea which in 1920 was adopted in Hungary, where an artist conceived a poster showing a child with uplifted fingers saying to its mother in solemn warning, "Mother, remember me. Vote for a social democrat." This poster was forbidden by the censor, and a few days afterwards appeared on all street corners as that of the Christian Socialist Party. People of the Balkans found that Western Europeans were impressed by figures, so that they issued lists of schools whose pupils were more numerous than the total population of the villages in which they were situated. Frequently, a village would be stated on the sworn testimony of its most respected inmates, to be exclusively filled with persons, say, of Nation A. Not for a moment would it be admitted that the population might perhaps be mixed, and very possibly, on going to investigate, the Western European would discover that the village was entirely uninhabited and had been so for many years. We must also have some understanding of the old Balkan humor, if we are not to resent, for example, that story which they tell of a Bulgarian minister, who happened to be sojourning last year in Yugoslavia at a time when a great memorial service was being held for 99 priests whom the Bulgars had assassinated during their occupation of Serbia in the European War. This minister cherishes the hope that his country and Yugoslavia will bury the hatchet. "How unfortunate," said he, "are these recriminations? I shall have pleasure in sending them 99 priests, whom they can kill, and then we can be good friends." Thus we have two points of mutual esteem. The vast majority of people in Belgrade and Sofia are not chauvinist. Let them close their ears to the wild professors who, in their spare time, busy themselves with writing books and discoursing on politics, a task for which they are imperfectly fitted. One must naturally make allowances for these small countries, which have been so sparsely furnished hitherto with men of education that the government considered it must mobilize them all. Thus the professors found themselves enlisted in the service of the state. Unluckily, to give examples would be painful. It too often happened that the poor professor damaged irretrievably his reputation and held up the state to ribald laughter. Those who belong to an old cultured nation are not always cognizant of the petty atmosphere, to say nothing of the petty salaries which is today the common lot of Balkan professors. A really eminent man who for 20 years has been a professor, not merely a teacher at Belgrade University, receives a very much smaller salary than that which the deputies have voted for themselves. Occasionally, these professors must be moved by feelings similar to those that were entertained by the Serbs of 1808, who, having thrown off the Turkish yoke which they were resolved never to bear again, earnestly expressed, and more than once, according to Count Romanov, quote, their own will which induced them to beg the Emperor Alexander to admit them to the number of his subjects. A resolute old man, a Balkan savant of my acquaintance, he told me that he was a savant, said one day that before all else he was a patriot, meaning by this that if in the course of his researches he came across a fact which to his mind was injurious for the past, present, or future of his native land, he would unhesitatingly sweep that fact into oblivion. And he seemed to be amazed that I should doubt the morality of such a procedure. Bristling with scorn, he refused to give me a definition of the word patriotism, and I am sure that, if he knows his Thoreau, he does not for a moment believe that he is amongst those who, quote, love the soil which makes their graves, but have no sympathy with the spirit which may still animate their clay. Patriotism is a maggot in their heads. May the people of Serbia and Bulgaria rather listen to such men as Nikolai Velimirovich, Bishop of Zica, who, to speak only of his sermons and lectures in our language, lives in the memory of so many in Great Britain and the United States on account of his wonderful eloquence, his sincerity, his profound patriotism, and the calm heights from which he surveys the future. For those who think with him, the Serbs, in uniting with the Croats, have already surmounted a more serious obstacle. They believe that for three reasons their union with the Bulgars is a more natural one. They practice the same religion, they use the same Cyrillic alphabet, and their civilization, springing from Byzantium, has been identical. The two people are bound to each other by the great Serbian Saint Sava, who strove to join them and who died at Trnovo in Bulgaria. Vladislav, the Serbian prince, asked for his body. Asin begged that the Bulgars might be allowed to keep it. But when the Serbs insisted, a most remarkable procession set out from Trnovo, bearing to his homeland the remains of him whom the Bulgars called our saint. If, then, the two people will for a few years demand that the misguided professors shall confine themselves to their original functions, and, likewise, those students who sit at the professor's feet, one may hope that in a few years the miserable past will be buried and all the Yugoslavs united in one state. The time has vanished when Serbia and Bulgaria stood, as it were, in a ring, face to face with one another, paying far more attention to the disputes of the moment than to those great unifying forces which we have mentioned. But now Serbia is a part of Yugoslavia, which has to deal with a greater Italy, a greater Romania, and others. And the question as to whether a certain town or district is to be Serbian or Bulgarian sinks into the background. Fortunately, in the Balkans, where one is nothing if not personal, you can express yourself concerning another gentleman with a degree of liberty that in Western Europe would be thought unpardonable. And so, if the Serbs and the Bulgars will in the main follow the tracks of their far-sighted leaders, they need not quite suppress their criticism of each other. No great animosity is aroused by such a statement as was made to me with regard to a dispossessed Macedonian prelate,
who had told me that he had appealed to the Archbishop of Canterbury in the hope that he would assist him to return to his diocese. I asked a member of another Balkan nationality whether he knew this ancient cleric of the extremely venerable aspect, and whether he knew what kind of political and religious propaganda had brought about his downfall.
"I know all about that old ruffian," he replied. "He stole over 50 pigs and 100 sheep, and about 25 cows and 200 pounds of fat."
Anyhow, if his lordship had heard that these accusations had been repeated in many places, he would have been far less indignant than if they had been printed in some unread newspaper or obscure pamphlet. Now, if the local writers cease from indulging their national partisanships, and God knows they have no lack of material, then perhaps the time will come when foreign publicists and politicians who keep one eye upon the Balkans will be able to speak well about the particular country which they affect without speaking ill about the neighboring countries, concerning which it is possible they know less. Of course, there are a number of real Balkan experts in various countries, judicious writers who will be gratefully mentioned in this book. And there are people such as Mr. Harold E. Goad, the vehement pro-Italian writer, who are quite amusing. This gentleman said in the Fortnightly Review, May 1922, that once he used to hold romantic views of Balkan politics, but now has ascertained that they are, quote, "usually plotted move by move in the coffee shops of petty capitals. Intrigue, bribery, and calumny, personal jealousy, and racial prejudice are the ordinary means with which the game is played." How different from the rest of Europe, where intrigue, etc., are conspicuously absent. And the explanation seems to be that wine and beer are unlike coffee, which it may be quite impossible to drink without remembering the poison which so many furtive fingers have dropped into it. And it would be rank ingratitude if I omitted the Italian Admiral Milo, though he was injudicious. After he had been at his post for 4 months with the resounding title of Governor of Dalmatia and of the Dalmatian Islands and of the island of Kurzala, he told me that he found it most fascinating to motor through Dalmatia's rocky hinterland, where the natives had the dignified air of ancient Roman senators and even greeted you in Latin. This was rather a startling statement.
"Oh, yes,"
said the admiral, with his aristocratic, bearded face wearing an expression of even keener intelligence than usual.
"I can assure you,"
quoth he,
"that the peasants say Ave. I heard them quite distinctly."
It was perhaps inconsiderate of those worthy Croats not to shout with greater clearness the word Stravo, good luck, in order to prevent the admiral from riding off with a confused hearing of the second syllable. A certain excellent dispatch of his, of which more anon, makes him a writer on the Balkans. I know not whether he addressed it to his government a dispatch on the above discovery, thus intensifying the Italian resolve to cling to Dalmatia. In that case, his knowledge was unfortunate, but otherwise it is surely as delightful as, up here among the tree-clad mountains, are the glow-worms that go darting through the night. End of Section 1. Section 2 of The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1. The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1 by Henry Baerlein. Introduction. The Tragedy of a Frontier. Kiepert, the famous geographer, was able, as the result of his diligent researches and explorations, to correct many errors in former ethnological maps. But in the map of the Balkan Peninsula, which he published in 1870, the country between Kusendale, Turn, and Varanya is represented by a white space. And if the people who dwell in these wild, narrow valleys had been overlooked as thoroughly by subsequent congresses and frontier commissions, they would have been most grateful. They only asked this well-built, stubborn race that one should leave them to their own devices in their homes among the mountains where the lilac grows. They asked that one should leave them with their ancient superstitions, such as that of St. Petka, who inhabited a cavern high above the present road from Turn, while St. Therapon, so they say, lived by himself upon a neighboring rock. Inside the cavern now the water drips continuously and is collected in large bowls. These are St. Petka's tears, which are particularly beneficial, say the natives, for afflicted eyes. But though this region is so poor that, towards the end of the Turkish regime and during the War of Bulgarian Liberation and also in the winter of 1879-1880, the people were compelled through lack of flour to use a sort of white earth, Biela Zemlja. Yet this land was coveted, and now the maps no longer show an empty space, but a variety of names and a frontier line. From the nomenclature, we perceive that the region was visited of old by people who were not Slav, such as those who gave the mountain the name of Ruj, to a village the name of Aral, and to a river the name of Yerma, which has been explained as being derived from the Lydian Hermus, the river of St. Therapon's birthplace. The names of Latin coloring may either be memorials of the Romanized Thracians, or else may refer to the medieval Catholics, whether Saxon miners or traveling merchants. But there does not seem, in the veins of the present population, to be much trace of these other settlers or wayfarers. At any rate, the Slavs do not differ appreciably among themselves, and the drawings of a frontier line has been a peculiar hardship. One of the greatest misfortunes of the 19th century was the creation of separate Serbian and Bulgarian kingdoms, wherein there was so small an ethnological difference between these two branches of the Yugoslavs. And in those districts where a frontier runs, one sees especially how criminal it was to make this separation. Balkan philologists today will tell you, and even those who are in other respects the most rabid Serbs or Bulgars, that there is really no such thing as a Serbian and a Bulgarian language, but only groups of Yugoslav dialects. And yet, it pleased the great powers to prevent the union of the two Balkan brothers. In that region with which we are dealing, the Berlin Congress attempted to draw, with very inadequate maps, a frontier line along the watershed. And the commissioners who were sent to mark out this line, observing that many of the indicated points did not coincide with the watershed, thought it would be preferable to trace the frontier along the saddle, between the tributaries of the Morava on one side and of the Struma and the River of Turn on the other. As the region was, however, not uninhabited, the farmers were frequently cut off, as at Topli Dal and Priseka, from the meadows and the forests which they had regarded always as their own. Bismarck, speaking with indifference of, quote, "the fragments of nations that inhabit the Balkan Peninsula," could see in the national yearning of the Yugoslavs only a yearning for lawlessness and tumult. So he labored at his plan of dominating Europe with the mighty structure of the German, Austro-Hungarian, and Russian conservative empires. And if he built it over a stream of democracy, with results that are today apparent, who knows whether the statesmen of our day are not somewhere constructing a house which to our descendants will appear equally ridiculous. And anyhow, as we shall see, he was far from being the only offender at the Berlin Congress. If that particular strip of frontier had been drawn in the most unimpeachable fashion, it would still have been iniquitous. One may object that even if the people were divided by rough and ready methods,
that was no reason why they should oppose each other, and indeed a number of frontier incidents which occurred between the time of the Congress and 1885 were not regarded either by Serbs or by Bulgars as being serious obstacles to a union. But Russia and Austria, reveling in the intrigues, continued to pull the two states, now this way and now that, and all too frequently against each other. It can thus not be a matter of surprise if the rather inexperienced statesmen of those little countries fell into line with the two great powers and spent a good deal of their energies in assailing each other. So blind, alas, were these statesmen that all the tears of St. Petka would not have cured them. And now the two kindred people, so progressive in many ways, are, to speak of each people as a whole, further apart than when their shaggy forefathers came over the Carpathians. It has been the fate of the Yugoslavs, Slovenes, Croats, Serbs, and Bulgars, to live for centuries besides each other and be kept always by foreign masters isolated from each other. At rare intervals, as we shall see in following their history, a person has arisen who has tried, with altruistic or with selfish motives, to make some sort of union of the Yugoslavs. And now we will go back to the time when Slavs first wandered westward to the Balkans. End of Section 2.
Section 3 of The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1. The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1 by Henry Baerlein. Chapter 1. Glory and Disaster. Arrival of the Southern Slavs. The Slavs, who in the 5th, 6th, and 7th centuries came down from the Carpathian Mountains, were known until the 9th century as Slovenes, Slovensi. And if, as is natural, the Serbs and Croats wished to preserve their time-honored names, they will perhaps agree to call their whole country by the still more ancient name of Slovenia, instead of the merely geographical and not wholly popular term of Yugoslavia, considering that this name, Slovenia, found favor in the eyes of their great emperor, Stefan Dušan. One would imagine that the Serbs might adopt it in preference to the cumbrous Kingdom of the Serbs, Croats, and Slovenes, with its unlovely abbreviation into three letters of the alphabet. The Croats would be glad of this solution, and thus the Yugoslavs would, unlike their relatives, the Russians, the Poles, and the Czechs, have the satisfaction of living in a country called Slovenia, the land of the Slavs. But although this would be a happy solution, it seems much more probable that eventually the name Yugoslavia will be adopted. Everyone is agreed that one inclusive word answering to Britain and British is necessary.
Yevo naša, here are our men,
were the words used by the Serbs, Croats, and Slovenes as their troops marched past them in Paris during the Allied celebration of July 1919. The Serbian colonel of the Hajduk Vilko regiment, which was stationed at Split in 1920 and of which the other officers were chiefly Croats, the men Muslim and Catholic, used in his public addresses to speak of
our kingdom.
There are various objections to the word Yugoslavia. In the first place, it was introduced by the Austrians, who did not wish to call their subjects Serbs and Croats. In the second place, the term is a literal translation from the German and is against the laws of the Serbo-Croatian language. Another and more important objection is that the Bulgars, though Yugoslavs, are not included in Yugoslavia, and perhaps the name will be officially adopted when the Bulgars join the other southern Slavs. Their unfortunate democratic ways. These southern Slavs did not display the same genius for organization as the Germanic peoples or the Magyars at the period of their respective migrations. In communities of brethren or bratstva,
From the word brat, or brother, they had not raised up a king, but as a compensation they possessed a lofty moral code, a religion inspired by the worship of nature and by the principle of the immortality of the soul. Occupying themselves with agriculture and the rearing of cattle, it was not until they came into contact, that is to say, hostile contact, with their more organized neighbors that they were compelled to join together under the authority of a prince, a knez. The bad result of this profoundly democratic spirit was that the Slavs, not knowing how to keep united, fell under the yoke of other nations. From the interesting series of documents, Latin, Arabic, Byzantine, and others, which have been collected in Monumentus Glavinica by Miroslav Premro, notary public at Caporetto, and published in 1919 at Ljubljana, we can see that the Slovenes occupied a much greater extent of territory than do their descendants of our day. Quote,
Abortu vistulae per mensis patia.
To beyond the Taliamento, and from the Piave to the Adriatic, the Aegean, and the Black Sea. One of the earliest of the above-named Slovene princes was Samo, a Slovene by adoption who struggled in Pannonia against the Avars in the first half of the 7th century. It happened also in the year 626 that other Slovenes, as well as the Avars, attacked Constantinople. Both of them withdrew, the former being defeated at sea and the latter failing under the city walls. The Avars, having thus shown that they were vulnerable, had to bear an attack on a grand scale made upon them by the Slovenes. This attack being more shrewdly organized than any other transaction in which the Slovenes had as yet engaged, and yet they still appeared to be reluctant to form even a loosely knit state. They roamed about the Balkans and the adjacent countries to the northwest, seeking for lands that were adapted to their patriarchal organization. Not until the 9th century did they set up what might be called governments on the Adriatic littoral, where they had no hostility to fear from the last remaining Romans who were refugees in certain towns and islands. Two early states. The two most important of these Slav states were, firstly, that one, the predecessor of our modern Croatia, which extended from the mouth of the Roša in Istria to the mouth of the Cetina in central Dalmatia, and, secondly, to the southeast, a principality afterwards called Roška, in what is now western Serbia. In a little time, the Slavs began to have relations with the towns of the Dalmatian coast and with the islands which were nominally under the sway of Byzantium, but in consequence of their remoteness and their exposed position, had succeeded in becoming almost independent republics.
Ecclesiastical rocks. Now, Christianity had been definitely introduced in Dalmatia in the 4th century. But it was not until several centuries later that it made any headway with the Slavs, of whom the Croats, in the 9th century, were baptized by Frank missionaries. The arrival of the Slavs, by the by, had been sometimes looked upon with scanty favor by the popes. In July of the year 600, we find Gregory I saying in a letter to the Bishop of Salona that he was much disturbed at the news he had just received. Quote,
Desclavorum gente, que vobis voda imminet, affligor viamenter et cantorbor.
Similarly, the Council of Split branded the Slav missionaries as heretics and the Slav alphabet as the invention of the devil. While the Croats were falling under the dominion of the Franks, the Holy Brothers, St. Cyril and St. Methodius, who had been born at Salonika in 863, were carrying the first Slav book from Constantinople to Moravia, whither they traveled at the invitation of the Prince of Moravia, Rostislav. St. Cyril going as an apostle and theologian, St. Methodius as a statesman and organizer. This famous book was a translation from the Greek, but it was written in Paleo-Slav characters, the Glagolitic that were to become so venerated that when the French kings were crowned at Reims, their oath was sworn upon a Glagolitic copy of the Gospels. And the spirit of that earliest book was also Slav. It expresses the political and cultural resistance of Prince Rastislav against the state of the Franks, that is, against the German nationality, of whom it was feared that with the cross in front of them they would trample down forever the political liberties of the young Slav peoples. German theologians were giving a more and more dogmatic character to Western Christianity. Whereas the Christianity of the East was at that time more liberal, it gathered to itself the Slavs of Roshka and of the neighboring regions, such as southern Dalmatia, while the influence which it exerted was so powerful that when the Croats, after vacillating between the two churches, finally joined that of Rome, they took with them the old Slav liturgy that is used by them in many places on the mainland and the islands down to this day. Thus, their church became a national institution, and that in spite of all the long-continued efforts of the Vatican, as also of the Venetian Republic. The Roman Catholic hierarchy, by the way, is endeavoring to have this liturgy made lawful in the whole of Yugoslavia. The only opponent I met was a Jesuit at Zagreb who foresaw that the priests, being no longer obliged to learn Latin, might indeed omit to do so. Pope Pius X was likewise an opponent of the Slav liturgy because a Polish priest told him that it would lead to Pan-Slavism and hence to schism. But it is thought, among others, by the patriotic Prince Bishop Jegliech of Ljubljana, that the late Pope would have given his consent had it not been for Austria, which recoiled from what would have probably strengthened the Slav element. One of the cherished policies of Austria was to utilize in every possible way the religious differences between the southern Slavs. The Slavs and their neighbors. But the two states formed beside the Adriatic and in Roshka were not only separated from early days by their religion. They had quite different neighbors to deal with. In 887, the Croats imposed their will on the Venetians, against whom they had been for some time waging war, and not merely a defensive war. The Venetians having attacked the country in order to despoil it of timber and of people, whom they liked to sell in the markets of the Levant. In 887, however, after the defeat and death of their doge, Pietro Candiano, the Venetians were forced to pay, and paid without interruption down to the year 1000, an annual tribute to the Croats, who in return permitted them to sail freely on the Adriatic. Beside that sea, the Croats founded new towns, such as Šibenik, of which the Italian name is Šibeniko, and carried on an amicable intercourse with the autonomous Byzantine towns. Yadar, the picturesque modern capital which they came to call Zadar and the Venetian Zara. Trigorium, the delightful spot which is their Troger and the Venetian Trau, and so forth. These friendly relations existed both before 882 and subsequently, when the towns agreed to pay the Croats an annual tribute, in return for which the local provosts were confirmed in office by the rulers of Croatia. We have plentiful evidence from the ruins of royal castles and of the many churches built by the Slavs in this period, as well as from the discoveries of arms and ornaments that the people had attained to a condition of prosperity at the beginning of the 10th century, so we are told by the learned emperor and historian Constantine Porphyrogenitos. The Croatian Prince Tomislav could raise 100,000 infantry and 60,000 cavalry. He had likewise 80 large vessels, each with a crew of 40 men at his disposal, and 100 smaller ships with 10 to 20 men in each of them. As for the state of Roshka, protected on the south and west by formidable mountains, and in the very center of the Serbian tribes, it is there that the lore and customs of the people have survived in the purest form. Roshka was the land in which the love of liberty was always kept alive, and from there the expeditions used to sally forth, whose aim, frustrated many times, it was to found a powerful Serbian state. The chieftain, Joslav Kronomorovich, did, as a matter of fact, succeed in uniting his state with two others, one being in Bosnia and the other in Zeta, which is now Montenegrin. He even added three other provinces on the Adriatic coast. But after his death, the state was dissolved, and in the course of the conflicts which followed, the state of Zeta assumed the leadership. It had been necessary for these Serbian rulers of Roshka and Zeta to resist the frequent assaults not only of the Byzantines, but of the Bulgars.
Simeon the Bulgar. Frequent assaults is probably a correct description of what the Serb of that period had to endure at the hands of this particular opponent, the Bulgar. Having swarmed across the peninsula, the Bulgar was now in the act of consolidating a great kingdom, for this was the magnificent epoch of the Bulgarian Tsar Simeon, whose word ran far and wide from the Adriatic. The Bulgarian map, which exhibits the Tsardom at the death of Simeon, is painted in the same brown color, from opposite Corfu right across to the Black Sea, and up as far as the mouths of the Danube, which signifies that in those parts, including, of course, Macedonia, the word of Simeon was supreme. But the Serbian provinces of Roshka, Zeta, Bosnia, and some adjoining lands are painted brown and white, being hatched with white diagonal lines. And this indicates very candidly that in the northwest, Simeon was not omnipotent. We are indeed told in the letterpress that, quote, "On the other hand, Simeon meanwhile took the opportunity to settle accounts with the Serbians because of their perfidious policy, and he subjected them in the year 924. But doubtless, this was a kind of subjection which in 925 would have to be repeated, and this would account for one of Simeon's faithful chroniclers having made that allusion to perfidious policy. Of the Tsar himself, we are given an attractive picture. Unlike his father Boris, who patronized Slav literature for the reason that it made his state less permeable to Byzantine influence, Simeon had no political object in his encouragement of native literature. He was himself a man of letters, having studied at Constantinople. He was acquainted with Aristotle and Demosthenes. He discussed theology with the most eminent doctors of the church and of positive science, or of what was then regarded as such. He possessed everything which survived the great shipwreck of ancient thought. Not only did he found monasteries and schools, but he gathered writers round him, and in order to stimulate them, he himself wrote original books and translations, thus ennobling, we are told, the literary vocation in the eyes of his rude and warlike race. He would probably have smiled if he had known that one of his writers had attributed to him the subjection of the Serbs. But what one would like to learn is whether Macedonia, even then a kaleidoscope of races, was more or less completely under the shadow and the brilliance of his sword, more or less completely subjugated. 4 centuries later, the Serbs were to have a Macedonian empire, which, like Simeon's, dissolved on the death of its founder. To these old empires, the Serb and the Bulgar of our day are looking back, and it would be interesting to know if harassed Macedonia was calmly content to be first Bulgarian and then Serbian, or whether it was a calm of that eastern kind, which means that a ruler's assaults upon the people are infrequent.
What are the Bulgars? And now, as the matter is in dispute, it is necessary to examine the origin of the Bulgarian people. A band of Turanian or Bulgarian warriors, probably not over 10,000 in number, and led by one Asparach or Isparich, had crossed the Danube in the year 679, had subdued the Slav tribes in those parts, for the newcomers reaped the advantage of being a well-disciplined people, and by the end of the 8th century had settled down in their tents of felt along the banks of the Danube. Then, after another 100 years in the district bounded by Varna, Ruscik, and the Balkans, one may say that the original Turanians, a branch of the Huns, had been absorbed by the Slavs.
"The forefathers of the Bulgars," says the great Slavist Dr. Konstantin Jiracek of Prague in his History of the Bulgars, "are not the handful of Bulgars who conquered in 679 a part of Moesia along the Danube, but the Slavs who much earlier had settled in Moesia as well as in Thrace, Macedonia, Epirus, and almost the whole peninsula."
With regard to the retention of the name, there is an analogy in France, where the Gauls came under the subjection of German Franks, who ultimately disappeared but left their name to the country. So too the Greeks in Turkey, who call themselves Romi, the name of their former rulers, and their language Romica, though they are not Romans and do not speak Latin. To such an extent have the original Bulgars been absorbed by the Yugoslavs that even the most ancient known form of the Bulgarian language, dating from the 9th century, retains hardly any relics of the original Bulgarian tongue. And this tongue has, in our time, with the exception of a word or two, been entirely lost. There is a celebrated old Miss in Moscow, which Orientalists and historians have pondered over, and which has now been explained by the Finnish professor Mikulai and the Bulgarian professors Litarsky to be a chronology of Bulgarian pagan princes, of whom the first are rather fabulous. Here and there amid the old Slav are strange words which are supposed to signify Turanian chronology, cycles of lunar years. And in a village between Schumann and Preaslav, there was found an inscription of the Bulgarian Prince Omartag, about 802 to 830, where in the Greek language, for the Bulgars had at that period no writing of their own, he says that he built something, and amid the Greek there is the word Sigur Alem, which occurs also in the above-mentioned document and is regarded as Turanian. What we do know about this race is by no means so discreditable. It is true that they are reputed to have had no great esteem for the aged, and according to a Chinese chronicle of the year 545, quote, "the characters of their writing are like those of the barbarians." They held it to be glorious to die in battle, shameful to die of sickness. For the violation of a married woman, as well as for the hatching of plots and rebellions, the penalty was death. And if you seduced a girl, you were compelled to pay a fine, and also to marry her. Their sense of discipline, which served them so well in their contact with other people, was remarkably applied to their social life. Thus a stepson was under an obligation to marry his father's widow, a nephew the widow of his uncle, and a younger brother the widow of an elder. It may be that the two much-quoted writers who claim that the modern Bulgars are of this race were moved more by the admiration of such customs than by scientific scrutiny. One of them, Christoph, who assumed the name of Tartaro-Bulgar to show that he believed in his theories, is usually thought nowadays to have been more of a poet than a devotee of erudition. If he had been still more of a poet, approaching, say, Pencho Slavikov, we would take less objection to his waywardness. The other champion of that ancestry is Theodore Panef, who showed himself a brilliant and courageous officer during the war of 1912-1913. The fact that he was himself of Armenian origin, he changed his name, would, of course, not invalidate his Bulgarian studies. But even as he spoke Bulgarian with a Russian accent, so is he looked upon as writing like certain Russians. and his other literary work, such as that on the psychology of crowds, is held to be of more value. At all events, in 1916, when a number of Bulgarian deputies made a joyous progress to the capitals of their allies under the leadership of the vice president of the Sobranje, Dr. Momchilov, renowned at the time as a Germanophile, they were welcomed with great pomp at Budapest and declared in ceremonial orations to be brothers of the Turanian Magyars. But Momchilov deprecated this idea.
"We are brothers," he said, quote, "of the Russians, and see what we have done to them."
It was also during the war that Dr. Georgov, professor of philosophy and rector of Sofia University, wrote a dissertation in a Budapest newspaper which demonstrated very clearly to the Hungarians that the Bulgars are Slavs. The professor points out that the Turanians had so rapidly been absorbed that Prince Olmertag bestowed Slav names upon his sons. And this complete mingling of the radically different peoples was assisted, says the professor, by the fact that those Bulgarian hordes in the days before they crossed the Danube were already partly mixed with Slavs, since they had been wandering for decades to the north of the Danube, around Bessarabia, in which country the Slavs were members of the same Slovene race as those whom they were afterwards to meet. So thoroughly were the original Bulgars submerged in the Slavs that when their sons set out from the district between Varna, Ruscek, and the Balkans, proceeding west and south, they met with no resistance from the unorganized Slavs of Moesia and Thrace, owing to the circumstance that these latter did not feel that the new arrivals were strangers. In fact, says the professor, there are in the present Bulgarian people far fewer and far fainter traces of the original Bulgars than there are of the old Thracians, as also of the Greeks and of the different people who, in the course of the great migrations, probably left here and there some stragglers. Sir Charles Eliot says of the Bulgars that, though not originally Slavs, they have been completely Slavized, and all the ties arising from language, religion, and politics connect them with the Slavs, and not with Turkey or even Hungary. Professor Sivich, by the way, who in 1920 received the Patron's Medal of the Royal Geographical Society for his researches into Balkan ethnology, regards the author of Turkey in Europe as a greater authority in this field than himself. It is not easy, away from Montenegro in a few remote valleys, to find communities on the Balkan mainland that are altogether free from alien blood. Turks have come and gone. Crusaders of all nationalities have passed this way with their hangers-on. Here was the road from Europe to Asia, and here, amid the ruin of empires, lay much that was worth gathering. No doubt the Serbs, whose land was not so much a thoroughfare, have in their veins some Illyrian and other, but on the whole, much less non-Slav blood than the Bulgars. Still, when we consider some subsequent invasions of Bulgaria, we must ascertain how far they spread. For example, the Cumani, who arrived in the 13th century, were, according to Leon Kahan, Turks of the Kipchak nation, speaking a pure Turkish dialect. They, that is to say, the Gagaus, who are supposed to be their descendants, are now Christians. They speak modern Turkish and inhabit the shores of the Black Sea and the region of Adrianople. They have kept much to themselves and are recognizable by their dark faces, large teeth, and hirsute appearance. There are people who assert that all Bulgars have a physical divergence from other Yugoslavs. But, except if they happen to come across one of these Gagaus or some such person, it appears more likely that they saw what they went out to see. Naturally, if not very logically, those who regard the Bulgars in a hostile fashion have often brandished the arguments of Messrs. Tartaro-Bulgar and Panif. If they will be so good as to accept what I honestly believe is the truth with regard to this people, they may have the pleasure of denouncing the Bulgar even more, seeing that his Yugoslav blood gives him less excuse for being what he has been. We shall have occasion later on to discuss his primitive as well as his more refined vices, endeavoring to ascertain how far they are not shared by his neighbors and whether he has any virtues peculiar to himself. Stefan Nemanja. After this long excursion into troubled waters, we will go back to the Serbian states of Roška and Zeta. In the year 1168, the former of these was under the rule of Stefan Nemanja, 1168-1196, who bore the title of Grand Župan, which means chief of a province. He was on friendly terms with the ban, or governor of Bosnia, and with his assistance he added Zeta to his possessions. It was in his beneficial reign that the Bogomil heresy was propagated in Serbia, later on to spread through Bosnia and thence, under the name of Albigensian heresy, to France. Nemanja summoned an assembly to decide on a plan of action. They resolved that this heresy should be exterminated by force of arms, seeing that most of the population belonged to the Orthodox religion. But Nemanja was tolerant of the Catholic Church, which had a considerable following in the Serbian provinces of the Adriatic coast. And this attitude became him well, for although he was the son of Orthodox parents, he was born in a western part of the country where there was no Orthodox priest, so that he was baptized according to the Catholic rite and only joined the Orthodox Church at a considerably later date. A suggestive incident occurred in the year 1189, when Frederick Barbarossa, on his way to Constantinople and Jerusalem, was met at Nish by the Grand Župan, who presented him with corn, wine, oxen, and various other commodities, placed the Serbs under his protection, and concluded with him and with the Bulgars a military convention for the taking of Constantinople. When at last Nemanja was tired of fighting and administration, he withdrew to the splendid monastery of Studenica, which he had helped build, and afterwards to the promontory of Mount Athos, where his younger son, who called himself Sava and was to become the great Saint Sava, had, from his 17th year, embraced the monastic life. End of Section 3. Section 4 of The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1. The Birth of Yugoslavia, Volume 1 by Henry Baerlein. Chapter 1. Glory and Disaster. Part 2. The Slovenes are submerged. Meanwhile, the Slavs of Croatia, and those farther to the north and west, with whom was kept alive the old name of Slovene, had been at grips with various neighbors. It has been said of the Slovenes that, shepherds and peasants for the most part, they have practically no national history, seeing that when the realm of Samo, who was himself a Frank, came to an end, they were subjected to the Lombards, to the Bavarians, and finally to Charlemagne and his successors. Unlike the Serbs and the Croats, they had no warlike aristocracy. In fact, the only two Slovene magnates who displayed any national zeal were two counts of Celje, of whom the first rose to be ban of Croatia, and the second, Count Ulrich, the last of his race, was in 1486 assassinated by Hungarians in Belgrade, thus causing his domains to fall to the Habsburgs. But if the little scattered Slovene people had to bend before the storm, if they withdrew from their outposts in the two Austrias, in northern Styria, in Tyrol, in the plains of Friul, and in Venetia, they settled down 13 centuries ago in a region which they still inhabit. This is bounded in the north approximately by the line extending from Vilok, Sjelovik, Klagenfurt, Spielfeld, Radgona, Radkersburg, and the mouth of the River Mur, although there are noteworthy fragments at each end. About 65,000 on the hills to the west of the Isonzo, of whom 40,000 have been since 1866 under Italy,
and about 120,000 partly Catholics and partly Protestants who live on the other bank of the Moor. Anyone who wished to follow the fortunes of the Slovenes through the Middle Ages would have chiefly to consult the chronicles of the Holy Roman Empire. He would find them in their old home at Gorica, but with a German count placed over them. He would find them being gradually supplanted by the Germans in such towns as Maribor, Maribyrg, and Radgona, being thrust out to the villages and the countryside. Nowhere except in the province of Carniola would he find a homogeneous Slovene population. It is an interesting fact that in the 15th century, theirs was the domestic language of the Habsburgs, even as in our time the Subian Viennese. But until the era of Napoleon, they took practically no part in the world's affairs, and the part which they were wont to take was to fight other people's battles. For example, when the Venetians, in the midst of all their hectic merriment, were making the last stand, it was largely to the Scavoni, that is, Slovene regiments, that they entrusted their defense. We are told that there was no question of the loyalty and the fighting qualities of the Scavoni and of their sturdy fellow Slavs, the Morlocks of Dalmatia. It was not possible for the authorities to provide ships enough to bring over sufficient resources to maintain all those who were eager to fight. In spite of all the centuries of political suppression, the little Slovene people, which today only number 1,300,000, retained its identity with even more success than a certain frog in Ljubljana, their capital. For that wonderful creature, though preserving its shape in the middle of a black and white marble table at the museum, has allowed itself to become black and white marble. We shall see how Napoleon awoke the Slovenes, how Metternich put them to sleep again, how they roused themselves in 1848, and what a role they have played in the most recent history. The fate of the Croats. The Croats were to be much more prominent in the Middle Ages. They did not, it is true, always manage to hold their heads above water, but they can now look back with more gratification than regret on the interminable conflicts which they had to sustain against the Hungarians on the one hand, the Venetians on the other. The Hungarian monarch, anxious to have an outlet on the Adriatic, attempted to cajole the Croats into electing him as their king on the score of his being the brother of the wife of a late Croatian ruler. He secured by force what his pleadings had not gained him, and subsequently, the link between Croatia and Hungary was more than once broken and reunited within the space of a few years. At last, it was arranged that there was to be a purely personal union under the vigorous King Coloman. And so it continued, with varying interference on the part of the Hungarians, until the dynasty of Arpad became extinct in 1301. The functionary who represented the central power in Croatia, there being for part of this period a similar official for Slavonia, the adjoining province, had the title of Ban. He was at the head of the Croatian army. He pronounced sentences in the name of the king and had other functions, so that the office came to be regarded with profound respect by the Croats, and many of its holders tried to deserve the sentiment. Among the duties assumed by King Coloman was that of recovering from the Venetians those coastal towns and islands which had fallen to them, owing to the chaos in Croatia. For more than 200 years, that is, until the middle of the 14th century, this warfare between the Hungaro-Croatian king and Venice raged without interruption. Apparently, the Dalmatian towns and islands were most unwilling to come under the sway of Venice. We read everywhere of how they themselves put up a strenuous resistance. At Zadar, the capital, where Pope Alexander III had, in the year 1177, been welcomed by the people with rejoicings and Croatian songs, a chain was drawn across the harbor in 1202. For the people hoped in this way to keep out the Venetians, who, with a number of Frenchmen, were starting out on the famous Fourth Crusade. That enterprise, which ended on the outward journey underneath the walls of Constantinople,
The Venetians forced their way into Zadar, plundered and devastated it, and in order to mollify the Pope, who was indignant at crusaders having behaved in this fashion against a Christian town, they subscribed towards the building of the cathedral, but retained possession of the place, this time for over 150 years. Yet the holding of Zadar did not imply that of other Dalmatian towns. During this period, when Venice clung to the chief place, there were a good many changes in the not-distant town of Šibenik, which was now under the Hungarians, now under Paul Subic, Prince of Berbere, now under the ban Mladen II, now an autonomous town under Venice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.